actually going to introduce two colleagues of mine who are going to help me present this and who've really been in the front lines of doing this particular piece of work. Actually, here walking up is Jason Kahn, who has a PhD in the application of computers, computer technology to education from Tufts, and Peter Ducharme, who's a licensed clinical social worker. And before I turn this over to them, I'm just going to make a couple of comments in terms of motivation. I run the psychopharmacology program at Children's Hospital, and those of us in the field, as well as the public in large, has been aghast at how much we turn to psychotropics to control children's tempers who have. We're very dysregulated children at the, at the extreme of the bell-shaped curve in terms of not being able to control their tempers and doing really atrocious behavior. But no one likes putting these kids on antipsychotic medications to control their tempers when they're not truly psychotic. There's a question about whether they're bipolar or not, and that's a matter for the field. But I thought that the background to this particular project is conceptualizing these children as having something more like a learning disability or a touch of cerebral palsy affecting that part of their brain that helps them regulate their emotions. And the crux of the intervention is remediation and training, sort of focused, giving them focused, an ability to get feedback in real time as they're trying to do things that are frustrating on when they're losing emotional control so that they can practice trying to gain it. And theoretically, then strengthening those parts of their cerebral cortex that might, in fact, allow them to do that. So with that introduction, I'm going to turn this over to Jason and Peter, who are going to tell you about an innovative program that we're developing and actually have moved all the way to the phase of a clinical trial to start trying to look at our measures and our ability to measure change in these children.
Well, we're not, I mean, I was just going to blab on while we waited for the computer to come up.
Sure.
So, Joe, do you want to add anything?
No, go ahead.
All right. So, what we've been working on, so there are, in the current study we're doing on, there are four of us. So, Dr. Gonzalez, myself, Pete Ducharme, and Beth Worf have been working with us. And what we've been working on is, essentially, it's a game. It's called Rage Control. And it's not behind me quite yet, but what we wanted to do was give children a way to sort of interface with their emotional state. So when you play our game, what you do is you hook yourself up to a heart rate monitor. And cool, let's go to the next slide. And you see something that looks like that. And I don't know how many of you guys are familiar with this, but this is based a lot on the game of Space Invaders. And you've got, and when you play Space Invaders, you got two things falling at you. You have enemies falling at you. And we added this idea of putting friends coming at you too. And the reason we did that is we want these children to be constantly making a decision. We want them to be engaged in the task so that it triggers some sort of executive functioning response. So it's not just mash on the fire button and fire at your enemies. You also have to say, okay, well, is this an enemy or is this a friend? That requires some amount of cognitive control. And that can be difficult for our study population and for children with oppositional defiant disorder or aggression issues or anger issues, that can sort of trigger, that sort of action, that sort of decision can be a trigger for them. So we wanted to give them a sort of environment where they could practice this. And so what happens is, you fire at your enemies, but if you go over a predefined threshold, and right now it's measured in heart rate, you can't fire. The game keeps playing. So we never take a child out of a demanding situation. We feel like we want them to be working hard in their situations. And, we don't want them to sort of pull back. We want them to be engaged, and we want them to say, okay, well, I've got to come up with this regulation scheme while I'm in this demanding situation. So what you're looking at here is on the left, we've got an example of, you're firing, it's all working, you're under threshold, but if you go over, then what's happening on the right is you're firing a dud. So the enemies are still falling, but you can't fire. So the game still goes on. So I included this slide to sort of show what our current thinking is what's going on in the brain when we have these situations. The best place to start on this slide is down at the bottom, where we have hypothesized, you want some sort of optimal focus when you're engaged in a task. You don't want too little focus. You don't want to be completely removed from the situation, because then you're kind of like a vegetable. But if you have too much response, you can't attend. It's just too much stress. You can't handle it. So if you start at the bottom, we've sort of hypothesized there's this optimal region of focus. And that's sort of dependent, as we see it, on this sort of flow of catecholamines in the brain that happens when you're engaged in this executive functioning response. So that leads to a release of neurochemicals, which both affect focus and then have these physiological markers. So one of the things that happens when these neurochemicals come out is your heart rate goes up, along with many other things. And so we have all these things feed back into the gameplay, and we basically are creating a feedback loop where their heart rate is part of the game, your focus is, of course, part of the game, and then your ability to also mediate that response and relax is part of that, as part of the game. And we want the children to sort of feel, you know, we want them to build a situation where they are doing all three of these things, and all of these things are affecting how they do within the game. All right, so now I'm going to turn it over to Pete, who's going to talk a little bit about the design of the study that's going on, the type of skills he's trying to build with these children in an embedded therapy.
Thanks. So as Jason said, what we did is we took this game Rage Control and we embedded it into a cognitive behavioral protocol that is designed to help kids regulate their emotion and behavior when encountering stress. So what we did is we looked at it as taking five core skills and combining it with the Rage Control video game. So essentially you can think of the intervention as happening in three phases, where there's a psychoeducation component around the experience of anger and aggression, a skill acquisition phase where you're learning these techniques to control anger, and then a skill application phase where you're really trying it out in these stressful situations and seeing what happens. So right now we have an open label clinical trial going on our inpatient psychiatric unit, where our goal is to enroll 20 consecutive patients with elevated levels of anger and aggression. And this is despite, in some cases, being stable on psychopharm medication and still having these anger or aggression responses, or not being on medication at all. And we have a pre-post test design where we have a baseline measure. It's a self-report measure of anger and aggression on a validated scale. And then we have an emotional reactivity protocol where we give people a speed math task while they're hooked up to a heart rate monitor so we can see what their heart rate is doing while they're doing the task. We do this in the beginning. We do the five-session intervention. And then we do all these measures again at the last day of treatment. So what we wanted to do is provide a context and present just one case out of the study that we've been doing. And this particular person was a 17-year-old who was admitted to the unit with an eating disorder. Now, this particular patient arrived on the unit, and obviously some of the issues that she had was distortions around body image and food and such. And although her particular struggles were around eating, what we find is that her experience is actually quite similar to all the kids that we treat using this Rage Control intervention. And the issue comes down to that they're now forced to engage in therapy. They're confronting material that's very emotionally charged and difficult to deal with. And they lack the current coping skills to deal with this emotional and sort of reactivity. So what our goal is to then raise awareness to this reaction, and then through targeted practice be able to teach them how to control their physiological reaction through heart rate. So what we do is we start with a very basic method of controlling your heart rate, what we call the 3-3-6 method, where we're teaching kids to breathe in for 3 seconds, taking a deep breath, holding their breath for 3 seconds, and then exhaling for 6 seconds. So the goal is to start here and then really encourage them to keep trying new ways of breathing or new techniques to be able to self-regulate while in the game. Now, this particular patient was interesting because she was very concrete. She enjoyed the sort of algorithm of the 3-3-6 method. She thought it made sense. It was very easy for her to do. When she would start in the game, she had some initial success in it, but then as the game increased with being more challenging, she struggled a bit throughout each session to get better at the game. So around session 4, she started becoming really frustrated at the game, which is in part what we're trying to do, create a virtual stress where people can learn to apply these skills in different situations. So she's becoming increasingly stressed. What we tried to focus on for her was problem solving. So in many situations here, the kids will give up. But what we try to do is really get them to keep trying new strategies in order for them to have success in the game. So what we came up with is we cut just a little piece of audio of this session. It's about 30 seconds long, where we show how she went from frustration in the game to figuring out a new technique and having success at the game.
You're hearing her play the game right now. It's like the sound of her firing that woof-woof is it's not working. Can't fire
right now. I tried my hands relaxing, it didn't work. And I tried the swing step. Didn't work. I forgot that, but the swing set thing didn't work either.
Yeah.
And the breathing didn't seem to work very much. And I tried doing just in and out, holding it, and then I tried the 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2.
Again.
I think we may
it's
have
working.
Found it.
Yeah, it works.
So what happened for her is the algorithm of the breathing made perfect sense. She really struggled to count while she played the game at the same time. So what was not on the audio was that she really figured out she was just going to try to breathe slowly and not focus on the numbers, and that was able to really help her to have some more success in the game and really increase her ability to control her heart rate here. So I'm going to let Jason present some of the data from her.